Good afternoon. So this is the most difficult session. So I've decided not to have presentation. This is on quality and maintenance, preventive maintenance. So I set the tone in the morning when we're talking about quality and predictive maintenance. I think the biggest problem, at least in our company, across all our businesses, whether it is metals to apparel, biggest is quality consistency. It's not about the absolute quality, it is about consistency. And customer today is willing to take so-called a little less of the absolute quality, but he is not ready to take inconsistency, especially when it comes to intermediate. We are all intermediaries, right? We don't sell the product to the end consumer. So there is a processing that happens after we sell. There is further processing that happens, and then it goes to the customer. So one is consistency. And the second one, the main reason for inconsistency is equipment reliability for us. So when we talk about maintainability, and if you don't mind, if I can ask you some interactive questions, I hope that's okay. Let's see how the participation is. So what is your stated understanding of maintenance? Today we're talking about predictive maintenance, right? But what is your view on maintenance? Equipment maintenance, and in your case, it could be any of the equipment that we maintain. What is the challenges that you are facing? Then I'll address it in terms of how that can be tackled. Are there challenges you people face, or it's all well understood and we know what needs to be done?
As of now, we haven't faced any much challenges. It's only, you know, the critical equipment that needs to be maintained, which is done on a regular basis.
So failure or breakdowns is not a challenge for the for your industry? Okay. So what we did, we identified, we went actually, when we started collecting data from our factories, one, of course, we had a failure rate for each of the equipments. So we identified the critical equipments, one, from a perspective of bottlenecks, which you said, which are the equipments that are bottleneck. Second, which are the equipments which are more prone to failure. And third, which are the equipments, if it breaks down for any reason, there will be a complete halt in production. Okay, so these three is what we identified as the critical things for digitization. We didn't take the entire factory. We just decided on these three categories, and every factory we identified these three categories of equipments. Second thing we did was we looked at, are these equipment different in different factories or it is the same equipment? So we collected the failure data of these equipments. So I'll tell you our industry, we are in bauxite to alumina conversion, which is called refinery. We convert the alumina into metal, which is called smelter, and there's a power plant. And the final metal aluminum becomes end products. It could be a window, aluminum window, door, or it could be the foil, which goes into your chocolates, it goes into tablets, all of that. So that's the primary, what we call a secondary end product. So for each of the categories of our processes, from all the factories, we collected what are your top three failures, what are your top three constraints, and what are your top three production stoppers, and looked at the asset class in terms of commonality across all our factories. When we started standardization, we looked at, are these the same equipment that is currently being used? So we grouped them into which are the most prone to failure at a group level, at a refinery level, at a smelter level, at a power plant level, at a downstream level. And we got around totally across Hindalco, can you imagine how many equipments we would have got of this category? Total number of equipments we got was 53, which were, if we do well on those 53, we can have high probability of zero failure. So we identified those 53 across all our plants, around 18 plants. 53 were, because we are pretty good in maintenance, like you are saying. Nobody is bad. But to the next level, we put these 53 equipments at a system level. So for us, like a hot mill is a system. Hot mill consists of a motor. It consists of bearing. So the subsystems. When we looked at the data for failure at a subsystem level, our data didn't have it. Our data quality, now when I talked about in the morning of data quality, this is when we realized that we don't have the information that is required to be captured about these 53, 55 equipment. The quality was very bad. So we put, first we categorized the equipment with the same serial number, identified them as families, and then started collecting data for them for almost 1 year. Just to collect data, just, and rigorously collect data without any miss. And we said, don't worry about, earlier our strategy was improve maintenance across the factories, and we didn't get anywhere. Then when we brought the focused approach on choose those are critical, we did almost 1 year of data collection on all the failure modes, why it happened, when it fails, what are the conditions under which fail. And then we got some of these equipment, not all equipment we could digitally put a sensor. Many of them we could put digital sensors to start capturing the data in terms of what we call as condition monitoring. So earlier we were doing condition monitoring at a very specific interval. When we started adopting this program, we had condition monitoring a part of predictive digital asset management, where we collect critical data. For example, if you take a motor, you have to capture the current, you have to capture the shell vibration, you have to capture the winding temperature if you can. And then there are 3-4 parameters that you capture and try to see how do this play around. The digital world gives you the ability to correlate multiple parameters at the same time, right? So we figured out what are the reasons for a system to fail, and all of those subsystems that were prone to failure, we took it into reliability-centered maintenance. And reliability-centered maintenance is basically the fact is, in maintenance, there are two aspects. One is fix, break fix. The other one is improving the reliability. We were very good in break fixes. I mean, we had people who would fix the brakes in no time, and the line would start running. After that, nobody would bother to put data on why the failure happened. So this is one change we brought in, saying focus not on the fix, but on collecting data about why it happened, the root cause. And then put reliability-centered maintenance on top of that to address the root cause from a reliability perspective, including putting sensors and starting to collect data, deriving patterns. And I'll tell you one example. In one of the factories, a motor, particularly in the night shift, when there is nobody to look at the condition-based monitoring, it used to have vibrations for around 20 minutes, exactly around the same time every day, which we didn't know because we were not measuring it earlier. And the team actually saw why that happened, for that, what happens in the factory when the shift starts. So one thing which was very clear, that issue is happening when the shift is starting. So they went into why it's happening during shift start, and they figured out that, one, the operator who was working in that shift, training was an issue. Number two, there was another associated line where the equipments were getting turned on, and the spike was actually traveling onto the motor. Now, these insights is what we have got after we put the sensors and patched up. This is generally not possible for you to get if you are using your standard condition-based monitoring. So now what we have done after this reliability-centered maintenance, we have now correlated all these maintenance failures to which are those maintenance failures that has been contributing to quality issues in terms of inconsistency. Because every time there is a coil that gets stuck because of machine failure, its quality degrades. So earlier when we didn't correlate the maintenance with quality, we never had this insight that this quality defect got created at the time when the equipment went to breakdown. So what we did, actually we put a microscope on the coil to collect the pattern of defects through a very high-end camera. And collected the defects, and every time there was a failure which we knew, we would correlate that with the quality parameter on the coil, and we found huge correlation of how quality and preventive maintenance, maintenance issue play a role. Now we have done so far 3 projects with just the same approach. We have, out of 53, we have been able to do this on around 12 equipments now in the last 18 months. So now on the 12 equipments, our failure today is zero. In 18 months, we have been able to get that failure to zero. We have also changed the maintenance schedules from earlier time-based now to based on data. We have been able to change the maintenance schedule. However, there's a huge resistance from the maintenance people that whether they should really change the maintenance schedule. We are telling them, you just do it. Let's see. Nothing is going to happen. But adapting to this change that so far we have been doing maintenance every 6 months. Now you're telling me don't do it. And we are fixing schedule for maintenance by every piece of asset, not by asset class. We are not saying all motors have to be maintained every 6 months. No. We are saying this motor needs maintenance every 3 months. This bearing requires maintenance every 2 months. So we are now getting into personalized maintenance schedules for our critical weak equipments. So this is what, and this has been a very huge effort in terms of collecting data. So I come back to the data because that is where we all get stuck. The quality of data, same problem, okay? Root cause not put properly, documentation not there, registers written, there is no commonality of language that people have written. So we have corrected all that. We took 1 year to correct all that for this 53 equipments. Then we took another 8 months to identify and put those sensors. Now we are getting the benefits of what we had done for the last 18 months. Okay, so that's as simple as what we have done. Now I can open to questions.
I have one question. Yes. Since you said you work from the metal to now fashion and apparel, do you see any big difference between the quality management and predictive maintenance systems which is being followed in the metal industry and the apparel industry now?
Yeah, so metal industry is by far a little bit more challenging because there, one is, if you look at upstream, it's a continuous process. Whereas in a garment, you're still discrete manufacturing, right? So your cell concept is still holds good. For my downstream, you are very discrete. But for upstream, any one equipment goes down, the entire line is down, right? So for you, the challenge will be to identify, because your whole tag time will go for a toss. If any equipment fails on the line, you're going to disturb the rhythm of the line. So, but the practices in terms of what I told is applicable exactly to any industry. But in your case, I'm not really aware of which are your critical equipments which is prone to failure or which can disrupt your production.
I think
swing machine is the only one, right? That's the major one.
I'll tell about the Hydromini group.
Please.
We have 38 factories, but a machine downtime or lost time due to machine breakdown, it's issue for us. I know the other, but it breaks down. So there's no bottleneck. But still, to repair it, it takes about 5 to 10 minutes of a lost time in a line. So that's the issue. Now, we are struggling. We also have this time-based thing. So every 3 months, we maintain a machine. But the reality is, actual usage of the machine is not that. Sometimes the machine may be in just the yard. We don't have a sensor to look at the, now we are developing a sensor to look at needle downtime. Huh? Actual, what was the utilization like a car, either 6 months or 3,000 kilometers. Now, in our sewing machine, we don't have that data and some machines are old.
Right.
But so we waste, actually in our analysis also, we think we are wasting a lot of maintenance hours and maintenance engineers' work just by going through this routine schedule. Still not addressing the downtime.
Absolutely. And
that. We are using preventive machine maintenance schedule. But apart from that, we are giving the training for the operator right first time.
No, his point is you are spending a fixed cost on preventive maintenance. Why you go for preventive? Go by database maintenance.
Database maintenance.
If the machine requires. Yeah. But a larger part in our problem, the sewing machine area in our factories, lot of machines are malfunctioning, which we are not aware. They are giving you a bad production because you are noticing at the end of the production that a stitch are broken, it's not even, the SPI which you thought is not coming. So we don't know, the machines are malfunctioning. We only know when the machine breaks down. But if it is not giving you enough, like there are a machine, if you see below the machine, there's a bobbin.
Yes.
If it's not, tension is not proper.
Yeah.
It is giving you a puckering effect sometime and not a proper stitch, which you are noticing maybe at the end of the finishing.
Okay, so I'll give you a generic answer to this.
When we come to know about that defect, the operator can produce, we'll have to produce almost 100 or 150 pieces.
Yes.
Till the end time.
Yeah. So this, what I'm talking about, reliability-centered maintenance, is all about preventing the failure. Okay. Now, in your case, the concept is exactly the same. Do you know of the sewing machine, which is a subsystem of the sewing machine that is causing the problem? In your case, there is also a human problem. So yours is a little compounded because there is also the human element of the competency of the person who is doing the sewing, right? So this has to be addressed only through the training part.
Correct.
On the job training and certifications, competency certification.
That is what right first time approach has been very good, effective. So that every operator can check their pieces. And if defect is occurring at the moment, so after one or two pieces, he can come to know that this defect is, the machine is malfunctioning and we have to stop it and correct it.
But my only thought I will leave is, do you know in the entire machine, there are one or two weak areas which are prone to, subsystems which are prone to failure. Now, that is where most of the time, and we do not only stop talking about preventing it, we have done some innovation around that part. Is there something that we can do to detect it early by the pattern? Now, this is a very, very early stage. Very early stage. But we have got, when five things interact together, in your case, one is the operator, the pressure that is being put on the machine, the way the cloth is being moved, and the speed at which, because person to person, the speed will vary, right? You have to capture all of this. You will actually know what is the real cause for the breakdown of the machine. And that's what we have done. We actually captured the patterns of, before a failure occurs, what is the pattern that the machine goes through. And this is not come from, this is what the banking industry has been using for ages to detect fraud, right? What are the patterns that a fraudster commits before actually taking your money? Now it has become what we call as AI, which has become now very commoditized. But all the platforms that we spoke in the morning, it has an anomaly detection for you. The thing is to find a sensor. What are you going to pick up in the machine? And this is where experts can help who know the machine. Of course, I don't know the sewing machine beyond what I told you. But we have done up to the component level of failure, not just a subsystem level, including the component level. Which component of the subsystem is prone to more failure? And then correlate it with the events. So morning you heard one of the speakers saying, don't look at data as a data. When you talk about maintenance, you start looking at data as an event. And you have to categorize the events. What are the good events? What are the bad events? Good events are which will allow you to clearly go through without any problem. Bad events will result in a failure. So what today we are doing through the digital patches that we applied is, for every category of equipment, we have developed a good event and bad event model. Okay? We know if a motor, this is the good and bad. For a hot mill, this is a good and bad event model. That if any hot mill follows this model, this pattern, there won't be any failure. The moment the bad pattern starts to occur, we know in 24 hours it's going to fail. So we are now, how much can you prepone the time of the sense to you that it is going to break down? If you are going to get a sense 5 minutes before, it's of no use. So the technology today, if you can, this is expertise that is required. How much can you prepone the event in advance? So that, and what do we do in hot mill today when that event occurs, that where there is going to be a defect, we slow down the hot mill. Because we know that if you don't slow down anyway, you're going to have a quality defect. We bring down the run rate immediately. And the parameter, the moment you bring down the run rate, the mill doesn't stop. It just continues. It's exactly like a train. You know, you have the train to just keep going. But at some point in time, instead of stopping, I'm just saying if there is a bottleneck ahead, let me slow down. That is what we are now doing. Saying our aim is to not to let the line shut down or stop. Because one machine stops, there is a lot of melt loss for us. Huge amount of aluminium is you can imagine that, you know, one small equipment, a bearing breaks down in hot mill, the entire line comes to a stop and I have to take that metal out and scrap it. Okay? So we have realized it is better to slow down and run it until the next maintenance you can do in a shift change. But don't run it at the same speed when you know there is a problem likely to happen. Now we have started from 4 hours, now we have come to 24 hours. Over multiple iterations, we are not able to pick up the pattern before 24 hours of failure. And that happens only when you keep continuously feeding data about your failure. And these patterns are not about whether you fail or you don't fail. The patterns are what is a good operating condition. Now we have learned that if this thing, these parameters are working like this, a very likely probability that this machine will not fail. So that model you have to develop for your machine. And all of this platform that we talk about in the morning helps you do this. Your maintenance experts have to sit and put what are the components, what is the system, what is the subsystem, what are the components, which is the weakest component, which is the weakest subsystem, if you can align it, just go digital only for those. The second option you have is, let me go all digital, which doesn't help. It doesn't help. But if you can get this data, it helps a lot, both for quality. And quality, I'll tell you what you have done. On the quality, for us, the first pass yield is the most important. First pass yield is first time, what you called as first time right, right?
Right first time.
First, yeah, right first time. For us, the definition is every coil has to pass through a set of parameters, entire line, every process. In automobile or in a discrete, you set the parameter and it doesn't change much. But in actual continuous process, parameter starts changing on its own because of the processing. So we have established limits for each of the process parameters, saying if these process parameters cross that particular level, we declare the first pass yield for that process zero. So we have now gone first pass yield by each process. Every process first pass yield is one. If the parameters are within limit, it is zero if the parameters are outside limit. And then we have a set of around 15 stages that the whole, and the whole cumulative first pass yield is a multiplication of all the zeros and ones. So if you get one zero, your first pass yield is zero. So now the challenge for the plant is, and we measure it every hour. So if 1 hour they get everything one, they have a first pass yield. If even in one, every hour, if even one stage doesn't pass the limit, we ding them as first pass yield zero. So in our factories, if you see first pass yield of 28-29%, is very good because of the stringency that we have brought in. It does two things. One, it brings a lot of ownership to the person who is operating the machine because he knows that if anything goes wrong in the next 1 hour, I will get a zero in my first pass yield. So he is now measured on the machine's first pass yield. He is now measured on the machine's run rate. We have only two metrics for each of them, first pass yield and velocity. So any loss, either you lose velocity or first pass yield, he scores a zero. That machine operator scores a zero. So that is how we have inbuilt quality and maintenance into a digital thing. Both the data is automatically captured. Every hour, every machine first pass yield is declared on the board in the shop floor and they know what is the first pass yield. Any questions?
You have
looks like quality is not the area of concern. I mean, the maintenance is not the area of concern.
I thought so because it's only the sewing machine which is. But quality is a big concern, by the way.
We are still considered a primitive industry. And that's the reason probably focus on machinery maintenance and risks are not very high. The machine breaks down, production loss, which probably not considered a big thing for us so far. And that's the reason I don't see any questions coming. Yes.
But what in quality? When you say quality is a big concern, quality has got very wide parameters, right?
The quality, but they are not consistent for the quality.
Yes. I think quality controls are more based on human error rather than machine error.
Yes. This is quality to that
comes from. So yours is more of a human-led, human certification.
That's the reason this consistency is missing.
Right.
Because of the human error. If it's a machine error, probably you can fix it and then you can have a consistent quality coming.
This is just because of this also, ki quality is a, basically, this is my personal view, quality is a subjectivity also. Maybe one of the defect, maybe that is a minor, maybe that
no,
is passed
I think
me.
That's the old school now, that it is, subjective. Defect is a defect and most of the buyers recently I have seen, they have stopped distinguishing between a minor and a major. Defect is a defect.
No, it's no longer there now.
Yeah. It's defect is a defect. And some of us who are working, especially with the Japanese market, they get their goods 100% inspected in India. 100% inspection. If you are shipping 10,000 pieces, they will come with their team, or they have centers, authorized centers, where you have to send your merchandise. 100% goods will be inspected, and even a minor defect, they'll put a sticker on it, you have to repair it. It's not AQL or that kind of system. So defect is a defect. For a consumer, if you go and buy a shirt, if you find a small dot, you will prefer not to buy, unless there is no other piece available and you are really fascinated with that garment. Otherwise, you will not compromise. So, defect is a defect. So, it's more with the human error, I think.
So, for you, you are saying if the machine, the sewing machine is taken care, there's no reliability issue on the line, except the human factor?
Another thing which I feel, my experience, you have always an ample number of sewing machines. So, if a machine is giving you a trouble, you quickly replace that machine with another one and start going. And that machine is repaired subsequently. So it's not a critical part of the operation, the sewing machine. You always have some extra lines.
Extra lines.
Yes.
So,
you know, when you divide the machinery as critical, let's say like a boiler in our, that if that stops, is this working? Yeah. If that stops, the whole factory closes. And if that stops for an hour, everyone comes to know.
Yes.
Because you are at standstill. For these big machines, even the people who sold you the machines, they give you maintenance timetable. You fix up your own timetable for maintenance. On a long run, you really see that boilers, generators, these big things really don't tend to be so much of a problem. If they are, because those timetables are set for them. If they do break down, you try to get into an internal inquiry why it happened. And probably maintenance or preventive maintenance is more proactive there. But when you come to sewing machines, they could be thousands in number over the operation. But if you see their disruption cost would be much higher than that boiler that closed for an hour. Because not only does that may reduce your efficiency down on that particular day to a certain extent, but the damage also that it creates on the garment, if you were to add all that, would be much higher. But to be able to collect the data of every sewing machine, where it went wrong, how, is really a humongous job. And you may be saying that today or tomorrow you have to come out with some sort of a process to really see how that can be reduced to almost zero onto that process. Coming to quality, like what you said.
Can I respond on the maintenance
part?
I'll hold for a moment. See, your assumptions that, you know, of course, when a boiler goes down, it's a huge disruption for us because power shuts down. But you believe that maintenance practices are very standard, preventive maintenance happens. It is not the case. And you can, if somebody has worked in manufacturing other than garment, you'll know that people don't release the machines for preventive maintenance when it is supposed to release. It is a Indian industry's norm. I can tell you confidently that we just overrun and overwork our machines. So if it is not breakdown, why give it preventive maintenance? So let's run it. So this is the tendency today, that if it is not, while there is a preventive maintenance slippage, what I call as a slippage is how many times, what percentage of preventive maintenance schedules have not happened when it should have happened? Can you guess the percentage? Compliance to the PM schedule. Just take a guess on what is the compliance level.
Maybe 20-30%.
Compliance level.
Yes.
I mean, it's not bad. It's not so bad because they will be out of business.
No, I recently saw this.
You're right.
The flyover came down in Calcutta. It was due maintenance few years ago and they just painted it.
Correct. So it is 70% compliance. 30% is the slippage. Slippage is 30% of the time we don't adhere to the time that it is supposed to go for preventive maintenance. Now, if that 30% happens to be some of your critical equipments are there in the 30%, you had it. If the non-critical are there in 30%, doesn't matter. Now, what we are saying is, let's allow the 30% make it as a norm for the non-critical ones. We don't need to maintain. It's fine if we don't maintain. But those those that are identified critical, put all your efforts. And we have divided our maintenance teams into two teams now, which was never there. We have now set up brake fixers who are very good in fixing. They don't understand the reliability part. They just know when a machine breaks down, what to do to get it up and running at the fastest possible time. And the diagnostic is handed over to a reliability group. So you will not find maintenance people today, many of them, doing reliability as a their sole focus. They'll all be measured only on maintenance. So it also depends on what is the KRA for your maintenance people, in our case. So it's the most difficult part for us to get adherence and to make sure whenever they do preventive maintenance, they do everything that is supposed to be done. Because there also human element comes, right? Sab theek hai, you'll put all tick, you'll find all tick in the sheet. Okay? All tick. But only he knows what has been done, what has been fixed. No one else knows. Now those uncertainties are now getting removed because we are making it transparent. And we are also telling them, focus on those critical ones. Put your attention on that. It is yielding results. So from a broad brushing of maintenance strategy, we are now coming to focus on few critical. And to answer the machine questions, all your machines may not need that treatment. You may have to pick up maybe out of 100, which for 5 or 6, if at all, which are frequently breaking down. But if you are saying all 100 break down randomly, that's a bigger problem. So that's what, in ours, we found that it's not a random failure. There are certain equipment that are very prone to failure. We have been able to identify those and put a lot more attention on those. Just, and it saves cost, it brings focus, and then it then increases utilization. Yeah, now you had something, sir, on quality.
On quality, according to me, the major issue is human error. On this part of the country, we mainly manufacture more of a fashion garment, which is tends to be a little more complicated, and the product changes probably every 2 weeks in the chain line. And we still see we've spent a lot of time on change, how the change can happen as soon as possible. You get into where are the defects which are recurring and how to approach that at the earliest possible time. Those things are there. But in the end of the day, most of the defects are not the defects that are recurring. These are defects like random. You didn't have a defect in the last 10 pieces at a particular pace. Place and the 11th has come and 12th have come and the 13th got repaired. So by the time you figure out those two, it's already been repaired. But then when you start adding those two to in that huge product that is coming out, it adds up to a big volume. So really the approach really is what I have seen traveling overseas, that people working in the garment industry, people working at a certain product, what I noticed there was the worker's eye was on the product all the time. That discipline, bringing it here, is like really moving a mountain, that the worker working at a particular place, his eyes and mind is everywhere except the product. And really, I have tried speaking to people down the line, I've tried speaking to the managers, how do we measure the eye contact, like what he said, that they have the needle time.
There are devices to measure it, by the way.
Needle time.
Yeah.
How can I measure the eye time to the product? Is really something someone can solve that problem. I think the whole industry problem will be solved.
Okay, I can give a solution right away.
Okay.
It's a digital solution, but it's not a cultural solution. Your age is a bigger cultural issue, but digital solution exists today. And I don't know in what way you can implement it. We have put in all our trucks, which goes on the major highways, eyeball sensor of the driver. And which is not, by the way, it's not uncommon. Mining industry does it. We have now put it in all our major routes where the drivers drive for 18 hours. We have put the eyeball movement. The moment we sense that the driver is sleepy or his eyes are going not on the road somewhere else, we get a trigger in our control tower. And the control tower person calls the driver on his phone,
I don't know, you remember Samsung phone had it, right? You can, with the eyes, you can read it. It will scroll up.
So it is there. That technology today is there to.
The problem will be Mr. Tony Uppal would be getting 1,000 alerts every minute.
That's why I said this technology solution is available. But whether that's the right solution, I don't think so.
Okay.
Actually, you can do it. Uh-huh. You can actually, and it will.
You could pick up probably
10
people.
Okay.
No, no, so let me give you, this is a very good point you brought up. Uh-huh. And I will tell you exactly, morning I spoke about, we took emails of customers, distributors, and started looking at insights, right? When we looked at our formal NPS, that is our Net Promoter Score reports, we were not getting any, nothing was coming. I mean, so everybody was saying, "Ye toh known problem hai. This is, we already know." And he's, I agree with him, right? Every time we see something is not there now, we say, "Ye toh humko pata hai." We know it, right? But the question is then, why the hell you are not fixing it? That is where our biggest problem today is not that we don't know. So everybody said, just work on this year. Customers are telling us four things. Then when we proposed this solution, we went, first meeting, they said, no, this is intrusive. How can you actually do this? We said, no, we'll remove the names. We'll only take the content. We don't need, we will not take the name and we will not penalize the person for writing. Then they say, oh, aur kuch likha hoga, English acha nahi hai. All that, it's okay, but let's start. So we took 20 of our key account managers, 20, and then 20 distributors and dealers, got them in and said, we are trying this out. Let's see what comes out. So it required a lot of time to get them to agree that ye karna hai. Once they did it and came with the first insights, people said, ye toh pata hi nahi tha. And so you can see people's eyes glowing, saying, we never knew this. And that kind of brought up a lot of sensitivity among the people. You don't need to tell them. It just brings up sensitivity. So to that extent, I agree with you that it can be tried out. If your people are willing to be tried out, you can really analyze it and with few samples and see what comes out. You may be surprised.
Making people willing, that would be the biggest challenge.
Yes, that's going to be the biggest challenge. Okay, you have to pick. And if you can show five people, you can show, look, this is what you are supposed to do, but look at where all you are looking at. You don't need to send any other message to the others. It's very clear. They get it. And there's the difference between an Indonesia, Thailand, China versus India. Okay? This is the difference. This is the big difference. And that's why when he mentioned that, you know, don't underestimate our problems. Our problems are huge in quality and reliability. Across industry, our problems are huge because of our cultural mindset. It's not a problem with the people. It is the way we are brought up. So there was, and I can share 1 minute of my...
Yeah, sure.
So there was K.W. Kim, who was the managing director of LG in India for 5 years. Before that, he was in Korea. And before that, he was in China. So he traveled. He was here for five years. And then he joined Videocon as the managing director. Then he retired. So I happened to meet him in Korea when I was running this world-class manufacturing. World-class manufacturing for our challenge was not the process. It was precisely the why we don't do what we do, what we, people are told, versus China, where people do what they are told. They don't deviate. So he said four things about India. He said, if there is anybody who is most innovative in the world, it's Indians. And put in bracket also Jugaad, that word called Jugaad. Okay? Anybody who is most innovative in terms of thinking ideas, you guys are the best. You can give the most creative ideas. Where, he said, first failure of is you don't keep up your commitments to anybody, including yourself, to your organization. Forget about suppliers and customers. Yours is ho jayega. No problem means problem. He said, this is the biggest cultural issue, that you are actually not, when somebody says, I want it on a particular day, you're already thinking, if it is a week later, it's okay for me.
I think the same is happening in the politics.
Same thing. So I'm just telling you what he told, and this is not my, this thing. He said, culturally, four things. Third, he said, discipline. He said, most undisciplined, indisciplined workforce is in India. And he says, this goes with your innovativeness. You are innovative. So even if somebody is given a process, he wants to innovate on the job, saying, I can challenge this process. So we had one golden rule in the previous organization saying either you follow the SOP or write a better SOP. If you have a better thing to do, write it so that everybody can do it. But don't innovate on the SOPs as you do. So this is the fourth one he said is the way you treat your employees and suppliers. That's the same treatment your employees and suppliers give to your customers. And he was telling about in Korea, if somebody has to pay supplier on the 10th day, the supplier will get paid. But for us, if supplier has to be paid on 10th day, we will pay him on 20th day. But if customer doesn't pay us on the 10th day, we are not happy about it. He says, these are the only four things I have observed, and I can resonate a lot to my own company. This is true. And this shows up in our attitude towards quality, as well as the way we take care of our equipment. We do a lot of autonomous maintenance. You know, you own, you operate, you fix. We have that in a lot of our factories. The machine is given to the operator. We teach him how to do 7 steps of autonomous maintenance they follow. Whoever has done very well, their machines never fail. We have seen that. Whoever follows it religiously, the machines never fail.
On
so,
the positive side,
yes.
Sorry. On the positive side, when we spoke about quality, if you are consistent about what you want and data collection really became a big thing for us, that instead of collecting data from the lines itself, we designated people. Some people are hired who do not know anything about the trade, and they are supposed to pick up the data. They've been explained, and they're doing a fantastic job. We do see that going back to the people again and again with that data is making a difference.
Huge difference.
And yeah. The big question becomes is, are you being consistent in your demand? So a lot of industry, I would blame the industry also itself, that a lot of demand is laid in front. It is not followed on daily basis. People feel if we don't get the result in the next 15 days, they give up. It is impossible. It's like a process that should never die in your organization.
Absolutely.
And you will probably start keep seeing.
That's correct.
So on the positive side, I would not say, when you talk about Korea, you talk about Germany, you talk about these things, yes, there were certain positives over there as culture, you can say, as commitment, you may say. But when you really talk about commitment and culture, you know, I don't know when we inherited it, when Gunish said first interruption 60,000 million years ago, India probably inherited there. But to really go with the concept of that, we need to change it. We know the problem, we need to change it. If that culture is there for thousands of years, it is not going to go away in the next 5 years.
That's
but
right.
Yes, if you're consistent on it,
be on
you
it.
Will probably reach that place.
You will reach. Be yeah. on it for a longer period of yeah. time. Don't
so
give up.
As an industry, you can just see your own organization that if small organizations start changing that culture within their own organization, you'll have a bigger group and a
Absolutely.
Bigger area changing that
Absolutely.
Process.
Ripple effect will be huge. If just stay on it, be consistent with people and help them to show, rather than perception, if you show data and keep... In our own factory, people have now started to see, and it's self-realization, right? You don't need to go and tell him. So, yeah, please.